Hi, my name is Mike Habe. I'm a Senior Specialist Solutions Architect with AWS. And in today's Snackables, I want to discuss graph modeling, in particular, how you can discover a graph model using generative AI and diagram as code. So what draws you to graph in the first place is the promise of graph. And even if you're new to graph, you know that the basic building blocks of a graph are nodes and edges. Nodes shown here as circles represent real-world objects, and edges shown here as arrows represent relationships between objects. And that a graph is basically about modeling data in this form so that you can navigate those relationships. And from those building blocks, you can overcome some important technical challenges. You can combine data across silos, you can find connections or paths through complex data. You can work with heterogeneous data that has complex relationships, and indeed your data can be full of many-to-many relationships. And you can build some important use cases: social networking, recommendations, knowledge graphs, fraud detection, life sciences, network and IT operations, among many other use cases can be built on a graph database. And what all of these use cases have in common is that they have a highly connected data set, and then you can navigate that structure, and indeed that you can follow relationships based on strength of relationship. Now, Amazon Neptune is a purpose-built database within AWS that implements graph and has some important features. First of all, it is open. It supports the two main representations of graph that are available today: labeled property graph on Apache Tinkerpop, and the World Wide Web Consortium Resource Description Framework, or RDF model. And using these representations, you can achieve fast speeds of query billions of relationships with millisecond latency. Architecturally, Neptune has an architecture where six replicas of your data are maintained across three availability zones. And there's some important durability and high availability built into Neptune as a service. And it's flexible in supporting the three main query languages available today: Gremlin, OpenCypher, and Sparkle. So with graph, then, we no doubt have lofty ambitions, but we need to start somewhere. We need to start relatively simply. And so the proposal is to start with an easy graph model at the beginning of your graph journey. And the reason you would want to start easy is that graph modeling is unfamiliar even to experienced data architects. It's just hard to get the initial elements on paper. And a lesson we've learned from past projects is to avoid big modeling, where you build a very large model up front. Rather, you want to start with something rather simple, but something that the team can rally around. So an initial easy model needs to be something that is not a throwaway artifact, but rather something that you would build on. So what we propose that you need then is to produce an easy step one model that you can run now and ask questions of now. So let's consider the exit criteria for this easy model. It needs to be researched. In other words, it needs to demonstrate an understanding of the problem domain through research. It obviously needs to capture the essential business objects and the relationships. But you need to be able to deliver it fast, with low skill, and with simple tooling. Otherwise, it's not easy. But additionally, you need to be able to answer questions during a test drive. So a model is really only as good as its ability to answer the questions that you will have efficiently. You need to test that out and validate it during this easy phase. You want to avoid lock-in. As mentioned, Neptune supports the two dominant graph representations of RDF and labeled property graph. And in the early stages of the project, you may not have committed one way or the other, so your model needs to avoid locking in. But it needs to be a rallying picture that the team can rally around and that you can build on. So the approach we'll take is to use two basic tools to build your easy model. One is generative AI. In particular, we'll use a chat playground offered by the the Amazon Bedrock service, which gives you a chat interface to a large language model. We'll use the Anthropic Claude V2 model. And the model is trained on a vast corpus of knowledge. We can ask it questions like, what would a model for our problem domain look like? And it will give you plausible answers. Now, chat playgrounds tend to render text as answers, but we can ask it to render that text in the form of markup for diagram as code tools. In particular, we're going to leverage plantuml, which can produce diagrams from simple text markup, and large language models know how to generate such markup. This will allow us to see visually what the model looks like, and then from there we can iterate, make improvements to it, until it ends up looking the way we wish. So let's consider an example. Suppose you are a data architect for a public works company, and your company contracts construction companies, and you want to understand these construction companies, so you want to build a knowledge graph of the companies and how they're related to each other, and also whether one of these companies happens to appear on a legal exclusion list. All right, to show this, I'm going to use Amazon Bedrock, which has a chat playground. It allows me to have a conversation with a large language model. In this case, my model is Anthropic Claude version 2.1. It's a very simple interface. I write a prompt, I click on run, it gives me an answer. This can be conversational. I can keep asking it follow-on questions and it will add to its previous answer. I've already asked it some questions. So I asked it to describe a logical data model for a company exclusion list. And I want to be able to see companies, their relationships, and whether they have exclusions. It gave me a nice answer, which is here. So it described what such a model would look like, its entities, its relationships, and gave me some further explanation. We're off to a good start. Remember, the tooling needs to be simple, the effort needs to be simple, the model needs to be researched, and indeed the LLM is drawing on its vast corpus of knowledge here. Now, I want to check what it's given me, and I want to see this visually. So I ask it to draw it as a plantuml, UML class diagram. It responds with a code block of plantuml. Now, plantuml is a diagram as code tool. The idea is I can draw complex diagrams with simple markup. In the unified modeling language has been around for some time and is known for very intricate tooling. This is simple tooling, which passes the simplicity exit criterion that I had. And large language models know how to generate it. So I'm going to take this code block and paste it into a plant text, the plant text editor, which is a plantuml editor. I paste it in here on the left, and it renders the diagram on the right. So I can see this is what I have so far from the large language model. It has the makings of a data model for company exclusions. So I like what I have so far, but I'd like to add to it. I would like this model to show company relationships. It doesn't do so currently. So back in the playground, my next prompt will be to instruct the LLM that the model should indicate relationships between companies. And knowing the state of our conversation, it's able to generate an updated block of code for plantuml. I can take this, paste it into my editor, and we can see now that company relationships have been added. Great. So I would at this point like to just embellish this diagram a little bit. So what I'm going to do is reshape it a little bit into a form that I think fits my purpose very well. I will have a company class, an exclusion class, an exclusion criteria class. Companies will have names, industries, locations, and a company can have zero or more exclusions, and can have 0 or 1 current exclusions. Exclusions have a start date and end date, and also can refer to exclusion criteria. So there's a certain set of known exclusion types that I represent this way. I also represent customer relationships by having an association between companies whose properties include relationship type and established date. Now, this is a UML class diagram, but it maps well to graph. In particular, my convention is that classes represent types of nodes, its attributes represent node properties, associations, or the links that connect classes, represent edges. Their label represents edge labels. And when I have an association like related to that has its own attributes, these represent edge properties. Now let's test drive the model to validate it. We want to perform three steps. We want to generate some test data. We want to load that data into a Neptune database, and we want to query it. And significantly, the large language model can help us with all three steps. From our model, it can generate plausible test data. It can even provide OpenCypher create statements, allowing us to transactionally load this data into the Neptune database. And it can help us write the queries. And we provide a notebook demonstrating this concept of the link shown here. So we can, for example, ask questions, natural language questions like, which companies located in Texas have an exclusion or are directly related to a company with an exclusion? Behind the scenes, the large language model is able to generate a graph query based on this and answer the question, the company located in Texas is company C. Now, after you've had this initial win with the easy model, as the development process progresses, you need to evolve the model by adding detail to it and to potentially reshape it. There are all sorts of modeling considerations for performance in a graph. Considerations such as edge direction, whether something should be a node or property, generic versus specific edges, whether something should be a node or edge. These are important considerations that you may not have considered in the easy stage, but you want to consider them later on. We have an excellent Skills Builder course, Data Modeling for Amazon Neptune, that walks you through these considerations. But beyond this, you want to think big. A knowledge graph is a central piece of an enterprise architecture, so think beyond company exclusions. You're not just building a company exclusion graph, you're building a knowledge graph, which may include many other types of data. And think of what you've delivered with the company exclusions as a data product, not just a narrow component that addresses a requirement, but think of it as a product that a consumer of a data mesh marketplace could actually understand and consume and put to use. And really think of your graph as a central place to bring data together. Assume that your knowledge graph complements a mesh, that it is in fact a mesh scale meeting place for numerous data products. So in summary then, we showed that a great way to get started with graph is to produce that initial easy model, and that we can use generative AI and diagram as code to make the effort of creating that easy model straightforward. We were even able to generate sample data and to test it out, but that later on we have considerations such as adding detail, reshaping for performance, and just generally thinking big about our endeavor. Some additional resources. We have a blog post demonstrating this easy modeling approach at the link shown, and there's an accompanying notebook at the link shown. A related tool that goes the opposite direction and reverse engineers the data that's already in your Neptune database, draws it using plantuml, is available at the first link. And then our Neptune Demos Hub is a great resource for demonstrations of common graph use cases. That's the second link. You can deploy a Neptune cluster in your own AWS account within minutes at the link shown here. And our team would love to discuss further with you. Please contact us. Our email address is wwso-neptune-ssa@amazon.com. Really appreciate your time today. Thank you very much.